As Marco mentioned, I'm going to focus the next 30 minutes or so talking about how we can use competitions to advance science and how actually they've been used in machine learning over quite a few years now. I will be talking about the journey of the focus of the community on the challenges, what we worked on, and where we are today. So let me go. Yes. So first of all, I should mention that, of course, competitions are not new. Well, one of the first one we know about is the Longitude Prize, which dates back to 1714. And that challenge was actually established by the British Parliament, sorry, for anyone who could actually figure out how can we calculate this Longitude Prize. And at the time, they provided quite a lot of money, so like £20,000. And we see that at the beginning of the competitions, actually, money was quite an incentive for people to participate. The short story, it's the what happened is that the Admiral Sir Cloudesley Shovel, who was returning from Gibraltar, actually, and he had won a battle with the Royal Navy fleet after engaging with the French in the Mediterranean, but then they completely got off course. They thought they were west of Brittany, and actually they were really, really west of Brittany. They were actually close to the Scilly Islands, and they lost three or four ships there. And so that's the first prize we know about. The others, high visible prizes. Everybody we know also the DARPA Grand Challenge in the, I think it was 2005, which really helped bring the development of technologies to create autonomous ground vehicles. This one also with the money prizes, a large amount of monies. Other ones closer to this community, the Netflix Challenge, which was really about figuring out which were the best collaborative filtering algorithms to predict users' rating for films, and all that based on the ratings without any information of what the film was or the users. And here again, $1 million prize. Later on, actually, we've seen a plethora of challenges and not all million dollars. And challenges have also been used not just to bring solutions from machine learning or data science or AI to industry or just to advanced science, but also for training, so in the classroom. And we'll talk a bit more about that in a second. Also, more recently, they have been used in industry in a way to upskill the workforce, as we, for instance, at Microsoft, a software company, now a cloud-based company, and where data became a first-class citizen. So there was this need to start upskilling the workforce via hackathon and challenges. And last but not least, I will say that actually the competition have been in machine learning have been made official, as it were, as part of NeurIPS, with now a competition track part of the conference. So what's really the value of challenges? So when we look at competitions in machine learning, they actually have been proven to be efficient and cost-effective ways to bring industries rather solutions that may have been just confined in research or in labs. There is also a playful nature of challenges, which means that it's going to attract really a large set of people from students, making that also a great teaching resource, but also retirees who just want to participate, especially in challenges like the Kaggle challenges, but also, of course, developers. And so in that sense, when we look at challenges as competitions, they are actually one way of directing research to advance the state of the art and also venturing in completely new domains. There are issues, though, with the way challenges to date have been designed and implemented. First of all, there is a lot of duplication of effort. I was just mentioning that there is a plethora of challenges out there and lack of shared learning. There is also lack of reproducibility. And that was specifically because often we focus on the results with the leaderboards and not so much about the whole, actually, how was it done, right? And there is a way actually to really reproduce truly the experiment. Also absence of baselines, so difficult to collaborate. And last but not least, often challenges have been designed for this instant gratification, again, with the leaderboard. And without going deeper in terms, can we reuse actually, even if somebody is at the top of the leaderboard, is the solution a solution which can be generalized, which can be reused by others so that they can build on top of it. And so really what's needed when we start thinking about the designing high impact challenges, we need to reduce the preparation time and making sure that actually it's much easier for people, even when the challenge is done, that the outcome of everything which has been put in preparing that competitions can be reused potentially for another one. Reproducibility is extremely important because that's going to enable further participants and to share the approaches, potentially code, and of course also data. Benchmarking also extremely important so that we can have common measures. And last but not least, what we've seen is that leaderboards are good because there is kind of this playful nature and it's good to see if you're doing better than your neighbor. But at the same time, to really solve global challenges, we think that we need to move from just pure competitive, as it were, competitions to collaborative competitions or what we call here co-petitions. And how do we, are we able to actually create and design challenges which can help with that? And what are actually the challenges for the organizers as we do that? So the community looked at the plethora of challenges, so the challenge organizers across the globe decided to do something about it. And we started actually with my colleague Isabelle Guyon from Paris-Saclay. Back in 2014, we started a workshop at NeurIPS called Challenging Machine Learning. And actually, it's a series which has been running yearly since 2014, where we've been looking at the progress on designing competitions so that we can really make some progress towards having impact for the benefit of society. And so those challenges in machine learning, that's exactly what they're about. This is about bringing workshops organizers together, platform providers, but also participants in the sense of how are they using those platforms and then sharing all those best practices. And we said that at the beginning, we thought maybe we can just have one, two, three platforms. Absolutely not. Everybody still continues to design their own platforms. And there are some reasons for that. But at a minimum, can we have some interfaces where we can actually, well, if anything, share best practices, but potentially also share data and maybe some results. So one of, here's an example of best practices. This is kind of a summary of what I was mentioning earlier about working with the organizer of platforms, just sharing what works, what doesn't work. Also from participants, very interesting to see actually how participants are what they think actually of those challenges. And of course, companies who use those challenges to help find solutions. And then domain experts and actually data also, like it's really expensive to create good challenges. So the first one, so that's the very first workshop that we did organize. And it was about very broad topics about how do we do open innovation, how do we disseminate actually and have platform organizers and participate participants been recognized? What are some protocols we should be developing? And actually, that's where we started talking about, that's not enough to submit results. We really need to focus on reproducibility and submit also having the participant submit code also. And again, the idea of co-petition. It was actually in 2014, that was the year where Kaggle had the biggest challenge. That was the Higgs boson challenge, which was run on Kaggle, and they had about 2,000 participants there. And it was interesting. We managed to have the top two winners of that Kaggle competition, the Higgs boson, just to get the take from the participants, right? And what was important for them as they contributed their time and their knowledge to solving challenges. And what came out, I'll share a couple of those, but what came out here is that they are really serious, very serious competition participants out there. And I think Kaggle actually definitely encouraged that, that platform. And really what they were looking at, very thoughtful actually, like they really wanted to invest their time really well. And in a sense, they were asking for really impactful tasks. If participants are going to spend their time, they really want impactful tasks. And that's something we continue to see today, even more so, to solve global challenges for the benefit of society. And they also are interested in large test sets. And then on the, they also had some on the duration side, they say, you know, because they spend so much time on that. And of course, it's not their full-time job, right? So they were encouraging the challenge organizers to put like short time challenges, and specifically for MP, I'm of course focusing on the data-driven ones. So something like 6 weeks or so. And finally, having prizes, but actually, interestingly enough, at the beginning, I was talking about this $1 million prize, and there are still $3 million, $5 million prizes. But for data-driven challenges, actually, what came up here is that they were not so much interested in the prizes. And actually, when we look at the distribution of participants across data-driven challenges, the incentive is not the money, really. A little bit of money is fine, especially to travel to conferences to present the work, but otherwise it's really about the design of the challenge itself and kind of this fun part. And so they're interested in small prizes, intermediate milestones, and really participate with other, having rich discussions via forums with people. The next year, I'll try to go a bit quicker on the next ones. This one we focused, so we went deeper. So the first year actually, when we did it, there was so much uptake at NeurIPS in terms of, yes, we need to continue and to learn from each other. So we submitted again a proposal which was accepted at NeurIPS. And we tried to go a bit deeper on all of the topics we have been talking about in 2014. From the topic of open innovation, so what we wanted was to make data available, and having contestants or participants actually to a certain extent both formalize and solve a problem and leave actually more room to creativity, but also, I mean, the by doing that, it made it actually more difficult for the organizer to actually, how do you objectively assess the results? From the competition point of view, like focusing on going, instead of doing competitive competition, as it were, let's do collaborative ones or competition. So to encourage that, so how could we make the contributions? So as platform organizers, the contributions of many and having them contribute to solve an overall problem. And then one of the issues for the organizers here was, how do you reward partial contributions? So all of these different ideas, actually, they all came from either more challenges, but on others, actually, we did manage to move a bit more forward. Actually, on the platforms, I think everybody started agreeing that we really needed to make sure that it wasn't just about results, but really about how people were, the solutions that were even going to the top of the leaderboard. We had to bring other ways of evaluating the results, which were not just quantitative, but also how generalizable, sorry, are they, or can they be shared with others? And so really focusing on code submission. And actually on our side at Microsoft and with the community, with the peers of Microsoft and the community from actually CIML, Isabel Guyon, Percy Lien at Stanford, we worked on actually a platform, which is a Coda Lab, and really trying to capture all those ideas, or let's say most of it, most of them, in terms of a platform with a focus on reproducibility, where we could actually enable collaborative competitions and trying to make them easy for organizers to develop those platforms, and so that they could also focus on designing challenges to really advance the state of the art. Here are just a few examples of the evolution of the work we did over Coda Lab, which is this open source platform. As I mentioned, focused on reproducibility, of course, still accepting result submissions, leaderboards, and all that for the competition. But the big thing was about being able to submit code. And we did a challenge, the AutoML challenge, one of the first one we did, where we're trying to bring all this learning from those workshops. And the idea here with AutoML was a supervised learning challenge, where there were 30 data sets. And the challenge was to solve classification and regression problems. The difficulty is that there was really a broad diversity of data types, of distribution. Like, for instance, there were sparse, dense feature representations. There were sometimes missing values. And then there was also a wide variety of domains, like from there were medical diagnosis from laboratory analysis, there were some speech recognition, there were some credit ranking, et cetera, et cetera. And the idea here was, of course, there are some toolkits to do some of those independently, but the idea, because it's really, it requires considerable human effort, so the idea was really to create the perfect black box for a combination of data set, task, metric of evaluation, and also we constrained the computational time and just figuring out like what people could do. So it was a very challenging challenge, that one, and we learned quite a lot actually by doing it. Going back to more like the community in terms of challenges, we focused challenges on how can we use them for teaching tools. And so there we really focused the discussion on the benefits and the limitations of using competitions to give students problem-solving skills, to teach them best practices in machine learning, so also like to bring machine learning by actually doing, learning by doing. Also using challenges and continuous education and upskilling the enterprise, so using that as teaching, but as learning in the enterprise. And then how to make actually challenges more effective teaching aids. And finally, some actually professors also use it and started including the challenges in their curricula and involving actually students themselves to design those challenges as a means to educate them about rigorous experimental design, about doing reproducible research, and last but not least, project leadership. We focused the year, the challenges in machine learning in 2017, the focus there was on research tools, actually. And we wanted to explore how actually just when we look at the machine learning challenges, the competitions, how can we use them to have people design better research tools? And so also again with the idea of making sure that we could have methods to incentivize researchers to focus on aspects of research, like specifically as we're focusing here on collaborative AI. And another thing also still continuing with the focus of experimental design to foster contribution to push the state of the art. And that year there were different challenges, not all data-driven. We started looking at challenges, some of them which were more like life challenges. And one of them, which was really that I will highlight, was the MALMO challenge, which was the MALMO Collaborative AI Challenge, which was encouraging research to bring various problems such as how can AI agents learn to recognize someone's intent? How can AI agents learn what behaviors are helpful when working toward a common goal? Or how can they coordinate and communicate with one another to agree on a shared strategy for problem solving? And so there was this collaborative AI challenge built on the Minecraft platform, in which players had to work together to achieve a common goal. So that was also the idea of exploring it a bit, like how can you collaborate with an agent this time? As we continue evolving those challenges, we went beyond data-driven challenges. And here, as you can see in some of the pictures, it was really focusing on challenges in the wild. And actually, NeurIPS also, as part of the track competitions, also had some of those challenges. Like, for instance, they had the Learning to Run challenge. That was really interesting to see the, at least to us, like looking at how much work there still is to be done when we start taking ML in the wild, right, in the real setting. And so there were like very interesting, like in the middle there at the bottom in the picture, you can see, I think it was called, it's called Ducky Town. And I mean, some of those vehicles just didn't go very far there. So lots of good fun, but also lots of work to be done for bringing challenges, ML challenges in the wild. And then we started really focusing in 2019 on competitions for all. So moving away a little bit from the platforms and really looking at what's the real impact of the challenges in the world. And focusing, starting focusing more on how can we use those challenges for the benefit of society. And really realizing that at present, today, the geographic and the sociological repartition of challenge participants and even organizers is biased to a certain extent. Of course, with the recent successes in machine learning, we have much hopes to be able to democratize AI. But the reality is that today, the societal and economical benefits are in the hands of a few. And so, how can we change that? And that's exactly what this we started doing there, which was starting by enlarging the community of organizers, participants, and really fostering diversity with the participants and organizers, and really promoting the organization of impactful challenges for the benefit of more diverse communities. And I will highlight just a couple of talks there. I will encourage you to go there. One which was by Dina Machuve from the Nelson Mandela African Institute of Science and Technology, who talked about machine learning competitions, the outlook from Africa, and where she really emphasized the focus on capacity building and talked about the number of data sets really focus on real world problem. And so how can we bring more people to look into that? Another talk I will mention from Emily Bender, University of Washington, who talked about making stakeholder impacts visible in the evaluation cycle and towards fairness, integrated shared tasks and evaluation metrics, observing that the world is rife with unfairness. And then the AI system should not pursue this bias, or and actually this AI system need to pursue bias mitigation. And so, and the idea is really to integrate consideration of how this system impact all stakeholders. And so really, as you can see, it's like it's the shift from designing platforms to really the use of those challenges by people for people. I think I'm running out of time, so I just want to talk, I mean, to change a little bit gears and just mention that that these are some examples that that we have at Microsoft where we are working at on AI at scale. And there are many resources. You can go to that link there that are made available to the community. I will highlight just one maybe relevant for this community, which is the XGLUE dataset. And then also the first one on the left-hand side, I mean, when we look at some of those large models, we need to be really responsible on the use of those large scale models. And so we have specific programs around that, like to make sure that those, going back to the talk as I was mentioning earlier from Emily Bender from UDAP, that we understand actually what's in those large models, so efforts there. I will mention another example of AI at scale with dataset models and benchmarks called XGLUE. This one is it's a benchmark dataset, which is focused, so there are different datasets from the community and Microsoft. This is not just Microsoft, it's all open source. And you can see some of the tasks that are covered. And this is an open challenge. So going back to where we are with the CIML, the last one we had at NeurIPS 2020, we really focused, it was a very different type of workshop, as you can see, maybe just looking a little bit at the panelists, and really focusing on the challenges, all the concepts we have been as a community working on in terms of let's be more collaborative, let's share what we do, and really bring in a diverse community to figure out how to better design the next competition so that it can benefit a much larger population. So these are some of the ones. And I will end by saying that actually something that we discuss all across those challenges that, yes, there is value in using competitions to help, as I mentioned at the very beginning, to advance the state of the art. There are also many other advantages for industries. Now we are really focusing on solving global challenges for the benefit of society. We also acknowledge that actually platform organizers and participants, and specifically platform organizers, they it's very difficult for the platform organizers, specifically also in academia, to get the acknowledgement of the work they do, because it's not something that you publish easily, like here's how I created my challenge. And so just to finish, we are with Unity, it's a community book. We are working on a community book on AI competitions and benchmarks, and talking about the science behind the contests. And there are many many authors working on that. So you can, if you are interested, there is a link there. You can participate or just see where we are. And here are some of the topics that we are working on this challenge.